Hi, I'm Bridget Hillier. I'm one of the organizers at Strange Loop. In this series, we've been talking to previous speakers, but now that we have a program for this year, we're talking to some future speakers. Strange Loop is on in person this year. It's September 30th through October 2nd, 2021 in St. Louis, Missouri, USA. You can find out more information and get tickets at the website, thestrangeloop.com. Also this year, we have a virtual option. So if you aren't able to make it in person, you can still be part of the conference. So you can also find out information about that on the website. Today, I'm delighted to have Tejas Chopra here, who will be speaking this year in October. And the name of his talk is Carbon Footprint Aware Software Development. Thanks for being with me today, Tejas. It'll be nice to talk to you.
Yes, same here, Bridget. And thank you everyone for listening in. And I'm excited to talk about carbon footprint and software.
So today I'd just like to talk about some background and some things around carbon footprint aware software development. So my first question, when I saw your talk and the abstract, what I was first curious about is what led you to be interested in carbon footprint aware software development? Was it something you'd worked on, you know, some knowledge you had, something in your background?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think it's a series of steps that led me to where I am. The first thing I would say is that I got interested in Bitcoin in the year 2013, 2014, just when it was very nascent. And one of the things with Bitcoin was that, it's an energy gobbler. So I started reading more about it, more about proof of work. And I saw that, yes, in fact, Bitcoin actually consumes a lot of energy today. And that actually led me to take a step back and look at other areas of my life where, you know, I'm seeing carbon footprint, increase in carbon footprint. And there are two ways, really. One thing is, as a human being, you use a lot of services. You use your smartphone, you use the internet, you use a car. So those are things that you can definitely choose to buy stuff appropriately. And the other thing is, as a software developer, you work on software. And when I tried to research more into it, I realized that 4% of the total carbon footprint on this planet is contributed by software. So I know that it is not, 4% seems very minuscule compared to, you know, 20%, 30% that we have out there with cars, with, you know, agriculture and other things. So, but if you can make a dent in that 4%, because that is completely in your control, that would really go a long way in trying to make this planet better. So that was what was the motivation that I had. And then I connected it back to what I had learned in school. So I'm from Carnegie Mellon University. In school, we had lectures around, you know, how can you write more efficient software? And then I tried to club these two thoughts together. Can we write software that is efficient and better for the environment? And there are simple techniques as software engineers that you can employ in your day-to-day life. So that's where, you know, these dots connected, and that's how I got interested into it. And I've been using it in my work since that point on. And I am a strong advocate of, you know, making a change in the environment, because we should always leave back the world better than what we got it. So That's the motivation.
So Bitcoin, I'm not surprised to hear that was an inspiration there. When people think about this topic, that's, you know, the first thing they think of, because, yep, you know, there's a lot of talk about it. So based on what you've learned, what do you think the hope is for Bitcoin, for what could be done there to reduce the carbon footprint?
Sure. So one thing is that there is also a misnomer out there that Bitcoin energy is, like, Bitcoin is really bad for the environment. It is bad because it uses a lot of energy. But if you compare it to the industries it is trying to disrupt, such as traditional banking or gold, the energy usage in those areas or those industries is still much higher than Bitcoin. And if you look at what the aim of Bitcoin is, it is to actually give financial independence to people that are not really reached out by traditional banking. So it really will make people's lives better. So in that sense, I still feel that, you know, the energy usage in Bitcoin is a problem, but there are far bigger problems as well out there for reducing the energy consumption. That's the first point. The second point is that, yes, proof of work is bad for the environment. So it is, unfortunately, the way Bitcoin is designed, it will keep using proof of work. There are alternatives such as Ethereum, which use proof of stake. And with Ethereum 2.0, the amount of energy will go down by 99.9%. Wow. When ETH 2.0 just comes out. So that's the other thing. I have seen that recently Bitcoin proof of work algorithms, like the mining farms and all, they are using renewable energy sources at locations where previously we were not able to tap into them. So a very good example is El Salvador, which is introducing Bitcoin. They actually want to mine it using the volcano that they have. So energy from the volcano. So I think these are interesting ideas that people are coming up with to circumvent the problems. And these ideas can also be applied in other industries. So it's not really a lose-lose. I still feel that there is something to gain from our experience with Bitcoin. And with increase in usability, increase in scalability, things will get better. That's what I think, yeah.
It's nice to talk to somebody who has some real perspective on it and has thought through the problems, as opposed to just Bitcoin is bad for the environment. What do we do? So you work at Netflix, and it's, I think anybody would hear that and hear you talking about carbon footprint aware software development would then have the question, well, what is Netflix doing? And if, when you're thinking about things like that, like Bitcoin, Netflix has the potential to have a lot of impact if they were to employ things that improved their carbon footprint. So how has that affected how you look at how software development works at Netflix?
And this is a very pertinent question, because especially now that we are all in remote work in some ways, the streaming industry has boomed. We have so many streaming providers, and Netflix has 200 million subscribers, 200 million plus subscribers. So any dent that we can make in this space goes a long way to improve the environment. And it's also a very pertinent time, actually, because recently the Carbon Trust group did a study. It's an independent group. And they claimed in the study that an hour of streaming a Netflix movie in the UK, the amount of energy that it uses is equivalent to boiling a kettle for 6 minutes or like popping 4 bags of popcorn in a microwave. So in that sense, this has, and just to give you numbers there, it's 55 grams of carbon dioxide released in the air by streaming a Netflix movie for an hour. 50% of it is contributed by the last mile, which is the user's phone or user's device, which really you cannot control beyond an extent. 50% of it is then the network infrastructure, the data centers, the REST request calls, all of those taking up energy. And Netflix has gotten really better at it, because at the start of the year, it was around 100 grams of carbon dioxide for an hour, at least by some study. And now it is down to 55 grams. And it really has gotten better over the years. So we are aiming to be greenhouse emission neutral, I think that's the word, by 2022. So in wow. that sense, we are, as a company, very invested in, you know, making the environment better. And Netflix, again, has two parts to it. There is a physical production where you actually produce movies, and then there is a streaming part of it. The physical production is the one that generates a lot more carbon dioxide or has a bigger energy footprint than the streaming part. So to offset that, we would then buy credits, carbon credits, and that's how we'll get carbon neutral. So that's what Netflix is doing on that front. And I personally work on the storage infrastructure side. So I work as a part of a team that builds storage solutions for Netflix studios and streaming platforms. And we have petabytes to exabytes of storage that we deal with at Netflix. So what we try to do in our day-to-day work is, you know, write efficient code that reduces the footprint of storage in the cloud, which effectively then boils down to how much energy gets used in the cloud. One thing is that you pay for it and you have money for it, and that's fine. Like, Netflix has money. But the other thing is this good for the environment? And that's the bigger motivation for us as engineers here. Also, in my day-to-day work, I'm translating all these ideas into software techniques. For example, a simple thing like removing dead code, right? You may think that, fine, if you don't remove it, it's just lying there. But it actually takes up energy cycles to, you know, process it and not actually execute that dead code. So in some ways, these little steps, having event-driven architectures versus polling-based architectures, they are things that reduce your CPU usage and then translate into a better experience for the environment. So these are things that, you know, on top of my head that I can think of that we're doing as engineers here.
Well, that's great to hear that Netflix, and especially with those aggressive targets, like by 2022, that's great to hear. That's comforting. So some of the things you've talked about with the various points at which there's energy consumption, looking ahead to what the techniques are for carbon footprint aware software development, something I find as a software developer in doing profiling of things, one of the real big principles that you run into and what you run into in practice is knowing what you're actually measuring. You know, if you're measuring, you know, CPU cycles or memory usage of something, it's when you do the measurement, are you actually measuring the thing that you have that you can make an impact on? So thinking about that, what are your thoughts about how, what metrics there would be to see that you're improving things? And then how do you actually do the measuring on that?
That's a great question. And that's actually what I aspire to do as part of, you know, my job, where today when you write code, you have unit tests that catch your bugs and you have integration tests. You deploy your code, there are a bunch of tests that run, and then you know that whether it's good or not. And I aspire to make a framework where, you know, it's not just functionally correct code, but environmentally good code. So you will have a framework or a series of tests that you can run that, like you said, measure the memory usage, measure the CPU cycles of your code, measure the amount of spinning of your, like if you have spin locks anywhere, or detecting those kind of things in your code, and give you alternatives for those. Also stuff what compilers do these days, right? Loop unrolling, some of these things that you can do on your end. I think these would be good starting points. And then you can use a lot of static analysis tools that are already available in coding. So they would be a great starting point. And then, like you said, you know, flame graphs are a good way to know which function is being hit the most. And you can then get into that, like which particular function needs to be optimized the most for energy. So those are some of the tricks that you can start off with.
So one of the things that has got me interested in this topic is I did a lot of research and thought a lot about changing jobs, or, you know, moving in a professional direction to do something towards having some impact on climate change. You know, not that I was going to figure out anything that solved anything, but, you know, just try to move over into some industry that has more of an impact. And in the course of doing that, I found out a lot and made some decisions based on that. But I also talk to a lot of people, a lot of software developers in my network who are interested in the same thing. I've heard this from so many people. How do you think taking a look at the impact on climate change via the lens of carbon footprint aware software development, how does that, what advice would you give somebody who's thinking about that? Would it be better to say, go work at Tesla and help them produce electric cars, which is, you know, it's a direct impact on climate change, or using what you know about software development to make an impact on how software and services impact on climate change? Like, put another way, if I go work at Facebook and I know these methods and I can reduce their carbon footprint by 0.00, whatever, 1%, given how big their service is, versus doing something that's direct, like electric cars or solar panels. What advice would you give somebody in weighing those two options?
Sure. And I truly believe that electric cars are the future. If you look at the world 40, 50 years from now, what will the world look like? I think it'll be electric cars. It'll be cars that drive themselves. Probably not even cars. I don't even know what all will be there. But I do believe that, you know, at that scale, it would make a lot of sense for anyone to, you know, look for a career in building those. So definitely that would be the first pick. But a lot of us don't have options because electric cars haven't reached a lot of countries in the world. People do not have the technology to get there yet. So do you, as an engineer, wait till that comes over? Or do you try to move the needle, however tiny it is, to, you know, do your little bit in your day-to-day work? And Facebook is a great example, right? Like if you look at WhatsApp, the number of people it touches is like 2 billion plus in the world. Mm-hmm. So if you look at 0.001% of that, it's still a bigger number compared to, let's say, Tesla 2 years back, where it was just still a tiny fraction of the number of cars or emissions that happen. I agree that with time, we will come to a place where everyone would be working on something that is directly correlated to the environment. So if I were sitting in California, I would prefer Tesla going and making electric cars. But if I'm sitting in some remote corner of the world where I don't have many options, I can still try to work at some other company and write software, something that I live and breathe, in a way that, you know, can help the environment or move the needle a little bit. So I think no matter where you are, you can always find a way to do the right thing. So. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
that's some really good perspective. Something I've continued to think about, and, you know, a lot of people I know do. Thank you so much, Tejas. This has This has been great. Really interesting topic. And I'm very much looking forward to your talk. Can't wait to see you in person at Strange Loop in October. Thanks so much for agreeing to speak at the conference.
Absolutely. And I look forward to talking to everyone and finally coming out of this pandemic and meeting in person.